one, we talked about the Great Commission. We distinguished between the church and the kingdom. We said there are two different things. We said the church is the vehicle through which the kingdom is propagated and advanced. And Jesus came to establish a kingdom. He started off by saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repentance is the gateway to the straight and narrow path that leads to the kingdom. So we are called to be kingdom-minded people that handle kingdom affairs. And that is why when Jesus, before he ascended to heaven, he calls his disciples and he says, you will go to the four ends of the earth, teaching them what I have commanded you, and you will baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And he tells them, wait in Jerusalem, Acts chapter 1, until you are endued with power from on high, so that you will receive power to be my witnesses, to advance the kingdom. So it's all about the kingdom of God. And Jesus said something interesting to the Pharisees. He says, you are near to the kingdom. But their hypocrisy could not let them see the kingdom. So it's not everyone in the church that is in the kingdom. Not everyone in the church is going to heaven. Because the church is a spiritual organism. It's a spiritual body. Not a physical body. Yes, it's a physical structure. But it's a spiritual body. And the reason why we are in the church is to advance the kingdom. I'm just giving a recap of last week. And what Jesus did was that he set up the church. And he said, upon this rock, Matthew 16:19, I shall build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Amen. So Jesus has built his church to advance his kingdom.
Amen.
And because the church is the vehicle to advance the kingdom, he has to strengthen that vehicle. So what does he do? At his ascension, he releases 5 ascension gifts. Apostleship, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher. He releases those 5 gifts to the church for specific reasons. Why? For the perfecting of the saints. To equip the saints. Perfecting means to equip. For the perfecting of the saints. For the work of the ministry. The work of the ministry is to advance the kingdom.
Amen.
And for the edification of the body of Christ. Because he knows the body of Christ has to be strengthened as a whole body.
Amen.
Not just in part. It doesn't work when one part is strengthened and another part is not strengthened. So he releases these gifts so that the whole body of Christ can be edified, can be strengthened for the work of the ministry.
Amen.
And the work of the ministry is the advancement of the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Let us move on. If you would, please turn with me in your Bible to Matthew chapter 6. We're talking thy kingdom come. We're talking kingdom matters today. We must be kingdom-minded Christians. Matthew chapter 6. I begin from verse 31. Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. The kingdom that you're in knows your needs. And it's the business of the kingdom of God to supply your needs. Just like a government that supplies needs to those on welfare. The kingdom knows what you need. So Jesus is saying, don't be worrying about these things. Your Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. But seek ye first. Everybody say first.
First.
The kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Which things? The things he talked about in verse 31. What shall we eat? What shall we drink? What shall we be clothed? Possessions. Amen. Things that sustain life. Well, he says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. I want us to catch this quickly. Today we are talking about thy kingdom come, part two. The kingdom of God is tied to his righteousness.
Amen.
You cannot seek the kingdom of God apart from his righteousness. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Both of them must be sought together. You cannot divorce them because it is a righteous kingdom.
Amen.
And all these things shall be added unto you. So we are talking about the kingdom. How do we seek this kingdom? Is it just going and saying, in the name of Jesus, I seek the kingdom. In the name of Jesus, I seek the kingdom. How do we seek this kingdom? Jesus first told us to repent. Because when you repent, you're changing citizenship. Just like how you go before the immigration service here and you say, I want to be a citizen of this country. And I renounce my citizenship of my own country. So when you repent, you're changing citizenship from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of heaven.
Amen.
But how do I seek this kingdom? Let us turn in our Bible to Luke chapter 9 for more insight. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Luke chapter 9, I begin from verse 23. Luke chapter 9. Commencing from verse 23. And he said to them all, if any man come after me, let's look up, it's on the screen. Because there are some things that have to be taught, not necessarily preached. If any man come after me, you know what it is to come after him? He told the disciples, come follow me. That's come after me. That's what it means here. If any man come after me, that means you must pursue him. He must be your passion.
Amen.
And if you're coming after him, the first thing is that you have to deny yourself. Are you seeking the kingdom? You cannot find the kingdom if you don't deny yourself. You must deny your flesh. And take up his cross daily. Everybody say daily. Not that you take it up today and tomorrow you drop it. Next day you take it up, the next day you drop it. Daily. You come after me, you take up your cross daily. And follow me. Take up your cross daily and follow me. What does that talk about? That follow me is talking about a commitment. If you're seeking the kingdom of heaven and his righteousness, you must have a commitment to do so. You must be committed. Following is a commitment. If you're not committed, after a while you won't follow him. After a while you say, you know what, it's too hard. So I'm going back to my father's house, my mother's house. It's a commitment. And you have to take up your cross. You must come after me. Deny yourself. Take up your cross daily, follow me. That means you must yield to Christ.
Amen.
If you're seeking the kingdom, you must yield to Christ. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. But whosoever will lose his life, that is deny himself. That lose his life means deny himself. Whosoever will lose his life for my sake, the same shall save it. Verse 24 is simply talking about eternal life and hellfire. The same shall save it. For what is a man advantaged if he gain the whole world and lose himself or be cast away? What does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? You're gaining the whole world, it's not gaining the kingdom. Because friendship with the world makes you an enemy of the kingdom of God. So the Bible says, what does it profit a man if he should gain the whole world and lose his soul? A kingdom. kingdom-minded person understands that God did not place him on earth and give him intelligence, give him emotions, give him a heart, give him a will, simply to make money. God couldn't have placed us on earth just to make money. But we run after money like no man's business at the expense of the kingdom. You think God just created you and said, go to earth and make money? No. What does it profit a man to gain the whole world, lose his soul? It's all about the kingdom. God put you on earth so that you can reflect his glory. He put you on earth so that as it is happening in the kingdom of heaven, earth, the kingdom here on earth will reflect what is happening in heaven.
Amen.
And he wants us to advance that kingdom. Let's move on speedily.
Hallelujah.
For whosoever shall be ashamed of me and of my words, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he shall come in his own glory and in his Father's and of the holy angels. He's talking here about shame. He said, if you are ashamed of him and his words, there are Christians that are ashamed to profess Christ. He says he will be ashamed of you also in the company of his Father's angels. You see, Christ was humiliated, right? To die on a cross is humiliation. Christ was humiliated and subsequently exalted. So when you are a part of the kingdom, there is a degree of humiliation that you will be exposed to. There is a degree of mockery that you will be exposed to. People will look at you and say, you're weird. So there is a degree of humiliation you will have to endure. Those that don't want to endure that humiliation are ashamed of him and his words. So to escape from that humiliation, they are ashamed of Christ. So when they see somebody preaching on the train, they won't identify with the person. They can't even say amen. They can't even encourage their brother that is preaching on the train by just saying simple amen. So Christ experienced that degree of humiliation. And as you advance the kingdom, why did Christ suffer humiliation? He suffered humiliation because he was advancing the kingdom.
Amen.
Because when you advance the kingdom, religious spirits don't like that. Hey, 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 hey. We don't like that. What are you doing? So as Christ is advancing the kingdom, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the scribes, they all begin to conspire to nail him to a cross. So as you advance the kingdom, expect opposition. Expect a degree of humiliation from men. But your confidence is not in men. And he will exalt you, just as Christ was exalted after humiliation. The Bible says, for if you suffer with him, somebody complete it for me, you shall reign with him.
Amen.
Kingdom-minded people are not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's the power given to men for salvation. Verse 27, which is what I want you to catch, which is where we are going. But I tell you of a truth. There be some standing here which shall not taste of death. Some, not all of them, some. Which shall not taste of death till they see the kingdom of God. They had not seen the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God was at hand. But they have not seen the kingdom of God. He says, they shall not taste death till they see the kingdom of God. And they saw the kingdom of God when the Holy Spirit was poured out and the gospel was preached. That is why Jesus says, when they accused him of casting out demons by Beelzebub, he said, and if I cast them out by the finger of God, then you know that the kingdom of God of heaven has come. So the kingdom of God is seen when there's a manifestation of kingdom power. That's why the Bible says the kingdom of God is not about talk. It doesn't say the church is not about talk. The kingdom of God is not about talk. Not the church. Because in church we talk. In church we have to talk, we have to preach. But when there's a demonstration of power, that is the manifestation of the kingdom. Anytime the church of God demonstrates power, that is a manifestation of the kingdom. So he says, for you to see this kingdom, you have to deny yourself, take up your cross and follow him. Now, what's the problem? The problem is that many of us value other things more than we value the kingdom. That's a major problem. And the question you have to ask yourself, you have to be honest with yourself. I have to be honest with myself. I don't exempt myself. I have to be honest with myself as well. What is your passion? Seek ye first. If the kingdom of heaven is second, that is not your passion. Because there is a connection between treasure and the heart. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. But we value other things. And when you value something about the kingdom, that is what you will seek. Let us move on. Praise the Lord. Matthew chapter 13. Thy kingdom come. And we're talking about the kingdom. We have to be kingdom minded. Not just sit down in a church, sing hymns, pray, and go home. That doesn't cut it. Matthew chapter 13. Forgive me, I find it difficult to pronounce that English word. Matthew chapter 13. What can I say? I'm an African man. Verse 44. Matthew chapter 13, verse 44. Jesus wants to explain how the kingdom of heaven is like. And so he's going to use a parable to explain it so that we can grasp it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto treasure hid in a field. The which when a man had found, he hideth, and for joy thereof, goeth and selleth all that he hath, and buyeth that field. Look at this man. See what he did. Jesus is telling us what the kingdom of heaven is like. And he likens it to a man. A man that sold all that he had to buy a field. He sold all that he had to buy a field. Why? Because of the field. Because of the treasure that was hidden in the field. That treasure was hidden in the field. Ordinary eyes could not see that that field had treasure. But the man found the treasure and hid it. Went to sell all that he had so that he could buy the field. So he's going to buy the field at less than its value. If he goes to the owner of the field and said, do you know there's treasure in your field? The owner will say, really? Really where? As soon as the owner sees the treasure, he won't sell the field again. Or we jack up the price. Not so. We jack up the price. I come from an oil-producing country. If you go to certain areas where the land has oil, they're going to pay a fortune for it. But if you just go to another area where there's only sand, you will pay sand for it. So there's a treasure hidden in this field. And this man sold all that he had so that he can get the treasure hidden in the field. The treasure hidden in the field is the kingdom. So he sold all he had to get into the kingdom. And to sell all that you have means to part away with it. Right? When you sell your car, you parted away with your car. So he sold all that he had. Sometimes to get into the kingdom, sometimes to advance the kingdom, you have to get rid of certain people. Sometimes to advance the kingdom, You have to dispossess yourself of certain people, certain lifestyle, certain way of talking. You have to sell the way you talk. Sell it away. You don't need to talk that garbage anymore. Those four letter words. Because you are looking for that treasure that is in the field. Amen. Get rid of that lifestyle. Because why? You found a greater treasure.
Amen.
So that he can buy the field. Why? He was after the treasure. He was after the treasure. And this field, in a sense, is the gospel. And Jesus is the treasure. Christ is hidden in the gospel. But many cannot see him. Why? Because the Bible says to the Jews, he's a rock of offense. to the Greeks a stumbling block. So he's in the gospel, but they can't see him because he's hidden from their eyes. But this man found that field without treasure. Have you found the treasure? What are you doing with it? How are you making it yours? And the interesting thing is that this treasure wasn't like hidden in an enclosed garden. It was hidden in an open field. So anybody can access the field. It's not like, oh, you need to open a gate and go through a fence to get to a garden where the treasure is. No, it's in an open field. Like in the park. And they found it. And many times, we are not willing, many are not willing in the church. Many are not willing to give up their status for the kingdom. Many are not willing to give up their lifestyle, their position, their status, their influence for the sake of the kingdom. And that impedes the kingdom from advancing. You see, so long as that treasure is hidden in that field, catch this, that treasure cannot be used. We said the treasure is the kingdom. So long as it is hidden in that field, it is dormant. Not so. It's dormant. But once that treasure has been recovered by that man, now he can use it to move things.
Amen. Amen.
So when the kingdom, when you discover the kingdom, you get kingdom power. And then you can begin to move things in the spirit realm.
Amen.
But until you get that treasure, you can't move anything. Our dearly beloved brother K, he watches all our video. He will watch this video. He watches all our video. He told us a story here last year. He said when they went to rent their church in Maryland, right? He said, oh, he went. He said, oh, we want to rent a church, blah, 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 blah. And the banker looked at him. I said, please step aside. Let me talk to your wife. Why? Because the wife is the pharmacist. She has the money. She has the good job. He said so, right? Why? Because there was treasure that the banker needed. So, brother, he said it. He said, oh, pastor, I had to step aside. And I, that I thought I was the head of the church, the banker, instead of talking to me, the head of the church, was talking to my wife. I said, oh, would you sign this dotted line? Is the pastor supposed to sign? The banker said, no, don't worry, pastor. Let first lady sign. Why? Because of the treasure. So when you have treasure, kingdom treasure, you can move stuff. That's why the Bible says the kingdom of God is not about talk. Our beloved pastor was talking to the banker. The banker said, no, it's not about talk. I want to see financial power here. So first lady, step over. Pastor, we love you. God bless you. You're an anointed man of God. But first lady is who is going to sign the paper. Because the kingdom of heaven is not about talk. It's about a demonstration of the spirit. And the problem is, many are not willing to give up something for the kingdom. Just like that rich young ruler that came with all his self-righteousness. He had a bachelor's degree in self-righteousness, master's degree in self-righteousness, PhD in self-righteousness. And he comes before Jesus and just said, only one degree you're missing. You've got your PhD, but you're still missing one degree. You might say, what's that? He said, go and get rid of all those your degrees. Get rid of all your treasures. Sell them and give to the poor. Then come and follow me. The man looked at his wealth. He looked at the kingdom. And he valued his wealth, his possessions, more than the kingdom. And the Bible says he went away sad. So to move in the kingdom, to be a citizen of the kingdom, comes with a price. To be a member of a church doesn't come with a price. All you do is believe in Christ, praise the Lord, and sit down on a chair, and you're going to heaven. But to move in the kingdom and to be kingdom-minded, it comes with a price. When you found that treasure, you begin to act like people in the kingdom of heaven. You begin to pray. You begin to have intercessory prayer in your heart. You will begin to pray and pray and pray like you've never prayed before. Because you're praying a kingdom into manifestation.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Into manifestation.
Amen.
You want that kingdom to be advanced. You will, when the kingdom is within you, you will say, Lord, I pray for my brothers and sisters in far away Australia, that they will receive the gospel in Papua New Guinea. Why? Because you are birthing the kingdom that is in, within you in diverse places.
Amen.
You begin to pray for missionaries that are going with the gospel.
Amen.
That's how kingdom-minded believers operate. We said something last week. We said we will be mistaken if we think that deliverance is an end in itself. No, it's not. It's a means so that a hindrance, an impediment can be removed from you so that you can advance the kingdom.
Amen.
Deliverance is not for deliverance's sake, it's to advance the kingdom. We looked at two examples last week, Jesus healing. One he told to go and testify, one he told not to. Why? To advance for the sake of the gospel. To advance the kingdom. Let us close this message so that there's time for prayer, for deliverance.
Amen.
For whatever the Lord has in mind to do. As we close, let us go in our Bibles to Philippians chapter 3. We are kingdom-minded believers. Hallelujah. Philippians chapter 3. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I begin with verse 7. Paul is writing to the church in Philippi. He said, but what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. What is he saying there? What he is saying is that his desires were opposed to the desires of Christ. So those things that he counted as gain were actually a loss. So he wrote them, as accountants we say, in the ledger book as a loss, so that he might gain Christ. Because those things that he counted as gain were actually working as a barrier to his receiving Christ. What did he count as gain? He told us in the same book of Philippians. He says, for I, Pharisee of Pharisee. And he begins to list his accomplishments. Those were his gains. But those were the things that were actually impeding him from gaining Christ. And there are many people today, they count certain things as gain. But yet, they're not ready to release them for the sake of Christ. Kingdom-minded people are quick to release for the cause of the gospel. I told you of a couple. I won't mention their name. I'm godfather to their son. And they had accumulated money to buy a home. And in my former church, the Brooklyn Tabernacle, there was a building fund. And they already had a down payment, 20%. They had saved this money. And the Holy Spirit said to the man, put this in the building fund. The wife said, you must be crazy, to the man. And then after a while, Holy Spirit spoke to the woman. And she was now the one pushing the man and said, yes, we have to put it in the building fund. They were staying in an apartment off Flatbush. And they put that money in the Brooklyn Tabernacle building fund. What they did cost them an extra 7 years in that apartment. But now they have a beautiful house in New Jersey.
Amen.
A beautiful house in New Jersey. My wife and I, we had put money. I come out of homelessness. I got a good job. Started to save. And we're ready to buy a home. The Lord says, start a ministry. We say, okay. We wait for the people to come. We'll be doing it. When we raise money, then we'll start the ministry. The Lord says, no, start it with that money in your account. I say, oh Lord, which account? No, I'm serious. I said, Lord, which account? Which account are you talking about? My account or your account? But we had to release it. And eventually, he gave us our own home. You have to release it. It's not easy. But for the sake of Christ. For the sake of Christ. So you must be kingdom minded. If Christ can lay down his life, what is this that I cannot lay down? This thing that you can have today and it will disappear tomorrow. Money. Money is so fake, so fickle. You can have 1 million today and tomorrow you have nothing. What is money? Then I might gain Christ. Verse 8. Yea, doubtless. And I count all things. Everybody say all things.
All things.
And I, verse 8. And I count all things but loss. For the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord. I count all things but loss. All things. This was the problem with the rich young ruler. All things but loss. For the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord. For whom I have suffered the loss of all things. Hey! When you suffer loss, you go, ouch. I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but dung that I may win Christ. What is this saying? What is this saying? He said there is nothing he has that will stand between him and Christ. And Christ came to bring the kingdom. Christ is the kingdom bearer. He says nothing will stand between him and Christ. And since until we get to that point where to live is Christ and to die is gain, we are not really kingdom minded. A book I wrote like 3 years ago called Walking for Christ, I shared my experience that when we go to home fellowships, usually in home fellowships, it starts with praise and worship. Then somebody gives the word. And then after that, they take prayer requests. That's usually the format of a home fellowship. Is it cold in here? Are we okay? It's good. That usually is the format of a home fellowship. And I noticed in most home fellowship, what happens is when they take prayer requests, someone says, oh, pray for my aunt for healing. Pray for my son to get into college. Pray for me for a job. Those are good things. Don't get me wrong. Pray for this, pray for that, pray for my job, my boss is disturbing me. My boss is stressing me out. But nobody was really asking for prayer to take the gospel to other places in those home fellowships. Pray for me, I need deliverance, I can't sleep at night. But nobody was praying for the advancement of the kingdom. Very rarely did we see that. And that goes to show you why Christ will meet all your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. That goes to show you that many Christians are selfish. They're not selfless, they're selfish. It's about me, myself, and I. They're selfish. That goes to show you that many are not willing to lay down their lives for the sake of the kingdom. And we are called, he said, the first scripture we read, or one of the first scriptures we read tonight, he says, you want to be my disciple? You must come after me. To come after him means to do what he does. Deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. To follow him means what he does, you also will do. And so he laid down his life. He said, greater love hath no man than this, that a man laid down his life for his friend. And he has called us friends, because now we know everything that he is doing.
Amen.
He said, now I've called you friends. I laid down my life for my friend. Greater love hath no man than this. Amen. And as he has laid down his life for us, we are also called to lay down our life for one another. By this will all men know that you are my disciples. Amen. That you love one another. People in the kingdom love. Because it is love that drives us to advance the kingdom. Love. If you are a parent and you just happen to see your child about to cross the street, because you love him, you will violently yank him from the streets. When I take a walk with my son, I say, Daddy, don't hold my hand. When he's trying to cross the street, he wants to cross by himself. I say, no, I will hold your hand. Because this boy can do anything on the streets. Am I wrong? I don't know. And then sometimes he corrects me, want to cross. He says, no, Daddy, the light is red. Our teacher said, we have to wait for the, for the white. So love will compel you to advance the kingdom because souls are going to hellfire every day. And the kingdom of God needs to spread. That's why he gave the Great Commission, so that we can depopulate the kingdom of darkness.
Amen.
And bring people to the kingdom of light.
Amen.
It's because of love that we are compelled to preach the gospel of the kingdom.
Amen.
But if you see a Christian that just goes to church every Sunday and goes for maybe Wednesday prayer meeting or Thursday prayer meeting, and he's not really advancing the cause of the kingdom, he just comes to sit down, pastor preach, he go home, puts his money in the offering. He's not really advancing the cause of the kingdom. People are dying out there. The things that you're praying for to be added unto you, they will be added unto you when you seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness.
Amen.
God bless you. Father, I thank you. You're making us older to understand kingdom things. We thank you that the kingdom of heaven is like that treasure hidden in a field.
Amen.
Lord, we are ready to dispossess ourselves of everything we count as gain, that we might win that treasure in the field, our Lord Jesus Christ, that we might win that treasure in the field, the kingdom of heaven. Lord, that you will use us to propagate and advance the kingdom here on earth.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus, that you will use us, O God, to be soul harvesters. That through us, O God, Holy Spirit, you will work an enormous soul harvest.
Amen.
Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be workers in your kingdom.
Yes, Lord.
To be kingdom workers. To be kingdom-minded believers. We give you praise. Lord, use us for your glory. As you establish your kingdom here on earth, let your will in heaven be so upon earth. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's give the Lord a round of applause.